Thank you, Satya. First, let me congratulate you and Informatics team on successfully completing 40 years. And you brought in a lot of value addition to the profession, and we all know your contributions. Now, coming back to the topic, I'm happy and privileged to chair this session. We have a very, very relevant topic for today's webinar. And at the same time, we have an excellent speaker. And if I can say a sentence, first time I had a chance to listen to Professor Ganguly was in the year 2007 or 2008. I was in GE. We had invited him to deliver a talk on IPR at the GE's IP symposium. It was a fantastic speech. I still remember his talk on copyright in particular. And today, I'm privileged again chairing this session and also witnessing his talk. And without wasting much time, I would like to invite Professor Ganguly to talk on intertwining research with intellectual property rights for value enhancement. Professor Ganguly.
Hello. Well, a very good afternoon to all of you. The topic, as you see, is we have titled as intertwining research with intellectual property rights for value enhancement. So each one of these terms, as you see, is linked with the other. You cannot have one without the other. So unless and until you have ideas, you do research on it, you create knowledge, then from there you proceed to intellectual property rights, and then from there you look at options for value addition. Now, if I go to the first slide, the next slide, please. Now, in this particular slide, as you will see, that what we are saying is, why do we do all these things? We are doing all this for sustained societal growth. And for sustained societal growth, the only way you can do it is to have decisiveness. There is no compromising on excellence. It has to be inclusive because we have to cover everybody. And above all, when we do all these things, it's got to be fair. Now, the moment we couple all these together, they cannot operate independent of each other. So there has to be what we call as a dynamic synergy between the different operating stakeholders. Now, who are the operating stakeholders? So we go to the first part where we say that we have what I call as the wellsprings of knowledge. And obviously, the wellsprings of knowledge are educational centers, institutions, R&D institutions. These are the places where knowledge is generated. Then we have places where the knowledge is converted into certain type of products or services. And I call them as knowledge transformation channels. And these are our great entrepreneurs and industry. So simply generating a lot of knowledge, you cannot do very much unless this knowledge is converted into something that's very useful. So we need these knowledge transformational channels. So they are the people who deliver to society. Now, while doing this, we have other stakeholders like what we call as nourishing sources. We have funding agencies. The governments act as what I call as facilitation providers. They have to facilitate the process. So policies, infrastructure, and many other factors come in, and government plays a very major role in that. And all these, as we understand, functions in the framework of legal systems. And what are the legal systems? They're basically essentially a class of governance structures. So all these stakeholders have to somehow work together. One weak link in any one of these, the entire value chain gets affected. So we need to ensure that we look at these particular things holistically. And as we look into all these, we have to see the roles that will be played by each one of these stakeholders. Now from here, if I go to the next slide, so let's go to the next slide, and this slide tells you that this complex stakeholders which are there, all these stakeholders that we talked about. Now one additional stakeholder I brought in here, two additional ones, are the vendors. Because if there are no vendors, how will you get things delivered to you? So you need vendors, you need knowledge brokers, you need financial institutions, you need funding agencies, you need government agencies, you need regulatory bodies. Because it's not just good enough to make things, but some regulatory body tells you whether you can go to the market or you cannot go to the market, whether it is safe enough to go to the market or it's not yet so safe. So all those factors must come in. And of course, we have educational institutions, R&D institutions, individuals, startups, commercial enterprises, et cetera, et cetera. And all these are continuously interacting with one another, what I call as symbiotic processes of value creation and realization. Now, all these put together results in servicing people, markets, and therefore services society. And it is this holistic combination that brings value to society and sustainability in society. So while doing all these particular things, a very important part that for society to progress, there are unmet needs, there could be future needs, there could be issues, there could be problems, or there may not be any problems, but we may just create certain need for ourselves. So to do all this, innovation is a very, very essential and integral part of this symbiotic process. So it's only when we innovate, and innovate does not mean only technology. Innovation can come in any form. Even writing a poetry is an innovation. Even creating a marketing process is an innovation. So innovation is all pervasive. It's ideas that we have. We convert these ideas into actuals, and we will come and see at how we do these things and what is the innovation process that goes on. But before we go to innovation, let's go to the next slide. And let us see from all very complex what. So next slide. Yeah. So in this one, you will see that I brought in a quote from no other than a Nobel laureate, Rabindranath Tagore. And what did he say? I mean, this is my interpretation that he tried to talk about innovation. So I said, innovation is a determined process. This is my statement. But what is Tagore's statement? He says, if I can't make it through one door, I will go through another door, or I'll make a door. Something terrific will come no matter how dark the present. Now, see what a simplistic, in a simple manner, he has talked about innovation. That if I can't make it through one door, I will go through another door, or I'll make a door. So there are different forms. Therefore, innovations come in different shades and different types and things of that type. So we need to keep this in mind that we are constantly looking for the unknown. We are going into the unknown. We are looking at things and we are trying to create. We are trying to create options. We are trying to create solutions to our problems. And that's where different types of innovations come about. This is very important. Now, when it says, he says that, look, if I can't make it through a door, so I have a problem. It's an unmet need. How will I solve the unmet need? I'll go through another door. And I'll try and find another door. But if I don't find one, I'll create one door. So that's what innovation is all about. So it's a big challenge to take things through. Now, if we go to the next slide. Next slide, please. Now, here, what I define as a research trajectory. And while looking at the research trajectory, it's very important for us that we recall the learnings of the past in real time. That means we have a lot of things to learn of what has already, happened in the past. Because if you do not learn from the past, you'll not either. You'll be reinventing what has already been done and you'll waste your time. And therefore, this is where documentation, this is where archives, this is where libraries, this is where databases, this is where all these systems, the information systems, become extremely important and relevant. And this is where our information experts play a very important role in recalling learnings of the past, not just information, learnings. So the learnings of the past in real time. Then you merge it with present thoughts to do what? To address contemporary issues. So we address contemporary issues. And while addressing contemporary issues, what do? We store them, we archive them, we document them, and then we seed to unfurl the future. But to unfurl the future, someone has to dream the future. So it's a dreaming process that goes on, and therefore it's the whole cycle of past to present to future becomes a value chain. So this is something which is very important in terms of the value chain. So this is where we are talking about the research trajectory. So can we go to the next slide, please? So when we look at the research, and I call it research interwoven with intellectual property rights and research organizations, we start with concepts. We then go to the innovation process. We take the output. We go to the market. And while doing this, it's extremely important. But where do we start with the concepts? And if you look at the boxes which are given under each one of them, I've tried to simplify this in a very simple manner. That what is the problem that we have identified? So problem identification becomes important. Knowledge, we have to then landscape the knowledge in the open domain, and also a part of the knowledge for which intellectual property rights has been taken. So it's a total knowledge domain consists of a very open domain, which anybody can use, and some part where people have taken proprietorship through this process of intellectual property rights. So you landscape. You landscape this particular thing, and then you create strategic options for your work. And that is how the research problem gets identified, the research problem gets defined, the research problem gets focused, and then you start your exploratory work. And after you've had the proof of concept, then you decide whether you want to then protect your findings through intellectual property rights, or you want to make it open to the world without protecting it. It is your choice. Then once you have done that, you can then decide how you want to collaborate with others. You can then take options of how to transfer your knowledge to others. You can either transfer it by transferring your intellectual property rights as well, or you can transfer these particular things without the intellectual property rights. So it depends what you want to do, what value you want to derive out of it. And then you create a portfolio because it becomes an asset. Then you trade with that particular portfolio. You explore ways in which you will do transfer of this intellectual property rights. And very important that when it goes to the market, every product has a life cycle. You manage your portfolio. You find out how to derive value from it, monetize it. You have to see whether people are copying you or not copying you, and if people are copying you, and how do you enforce your rights? And in this entire process of the research and development, formal documentation and updating technological information becomes extremely important. And this is where our information scientists then work hand in hand with our researchers to really create value out of these. And the legal part comes in where you want to do the protection, you decide how you will protect and what tools of intellectual property rights you will protect. Very important in this is, very important in all this is that in most of our research institutions out there, apparently there is a problem with the audio. I don't know why, but is it better now? because some people have sent a message saying the audio is cracking. Is it audible now? Yeah. Now yes, I've come slightly in front, and I am going to do this from the front. So now what happens in all this is that there is scanty involvement of industry partners, and the regulatory considerations become extremely important in all these systems. So we need to bring all these together and look at it rather holistically. So this is very important. So as we go to the next slide, this is a very beautiful, the next slide is a very beautiful one. Can I have the next slide, please? Yeah. Now in this, you can see, I picked it up. I've given you the reference. You can go to the net and see these things in detail. But the interesting part is the entire value chain of creation, from innovation, protection, how do you leverage on intellectual property rights? How do you decide on priorities of projects? How do you create a strategic plan? And for businesses and industry, how industry creates a business strategic plan, integrates IP into it, and that comes out of a corporate strategic plan. And when you go to the upper part of this particular slide, you see there all these parts here, which is technology, environment, customer needs, competitor activity, partner ecosystem, legal environment, etc. You put all these things, and so it's a very important part where information plays a very important role together with research. So you can see that research cannot be done without information. It cannot be done without the knowledge. Our librarians have to play a very important role. Information scientists have to play a very important role. Researchers then use all these and work in tandem. And the legal profession, the legal professionals have to then see how to protect these particular things. And business strategies have to then take it further. And this is how it all goes to the market to derive value. So that's why the title, as we talked about, was about intertwining research with IP. Now there's a very important part that do you do these things? Now, when you look at most of our research organizations, barring many of the industries, and especially the major industries know how to do it very well. Not all industries know it how to do very well. But if you look at our research organizations, I mean, simple ones like universities, the IITs, and all the others. What are we doing there? We are essentially developing proof of concepts. And as we develop proof of concepts, can we go to the next slide? Very important that do we remain in watertight compartments? The point is that the process by which our research institutions interact with the outside world, namely when we are talking about the outside world and going and interacting with industry, interacting with society, and doing all these, we are extremely poor and weak in doing so, and therefore much of what we do actually does not reach the market. So the question therefore we should really address is, how can innovations with knowledge be pole vaulted across individual and institutional walls into the commercial and societal space? And this is where industry plays a very important role. And it is easy to state, academic industry interaction, but the question is, how do you do it? And this is where industry doesn't look at things unless it is IPR enabled. Technology assisted, knowledge incubation, transfer, for wealth realization. This is extremely important to bring all these, but wealth realization is a very important part. Otherwise, it is not sustainable. So this is a very important part that we need to really look at the whole process. Now, when we go to the next slide, this is a very loaded slide, but let me just tell you a very important thing. That when we have an asset, one is that there is a potential value of the asset. is the potential value of the asset. Now, from the potential value of the asset, and there is what is known the realizable value of the asset. So I may come and say that, look, this particular, for example, the cup which I'm holding, let's say that I think the potential of this particular asset, maybe it's 10 rupees, right? Potential. But when I go to the market, people look at this and say, oh, there are plenty of these like that available, so I'll give you only 2 rupees. So the realizable value of the asset then becomes 2 rupees. The potential asset, the potential may be 10 rupees. So I get 2 by 10. So the way to put it, as you see on the y-axis, I have said realizable value of IP to potential value of IP, right? So the realizable value of IP to potential value of IP is on the y-axis, and on the x-axis is how does innovation progress. This is the way it happens. Now look at the interesting part. In most of places that we do these things, when you go down out there in the corner here, you know, it's idea and conception. This is where research starts, that we have an idea. We conceive this particular bit. And then from this idea and conception, what do we do as researchers? We narrow down the options and we position this particular thing in the protected knowledge grid. This we call as, how do we place our idea and conception within the framework of what is known as prior art? And this is the prior knowledge, which is already there in literature. So how do we look at the prior art? How do we look at the knowledge that is already there? And how do we map our idea and conception vis-a-vis this? And doing this, we then do our research and we come to a proof of concept. Now, in most of the research centers that we work, we come really up to the proof of concept. Now, after we come to the proof of concept, now you can see as we, this is not a linear process, but as we go up in this particular value chain across from ideas, conceptions, and as we go along this particular value chain to crystallization to tangibles, then we go into what are marketable probables, because not everything can be marketed. So we have to shortlist what can be marketed. Then it cannot go to markets without seeking regulatory clearances. Then we have products and processes which are marketable. There's market acceptability, there's competitive sustenance, and then everything has a life cycle, both technology and products. So when you look at all these, what happens? When you go up this particular value chain, obviously, if you go to the y-axis, the realizable value of IP to potential value starts going up as you go this way. And this is where, post the proof of concept, post this proof of concept, this is where industry comes into play. And our interaction with industry becomes very important, because industry then takes it further from here up. So the research part is all here. The development part starts here. And industry puts in a huge amount of investment to really take it from here to there. And while doing that, from here to here, all the way from idea conception to here, we have to manage intellectual property rights. And therefore, this green part here is all the part which is very important of how do you manage intellectual property rights. And these are various activities that you do while managing your intellectual property rights. And that's what brings value to all the work that we do. And therefore, you are intertwining. Now, very important. That see, when you are just at the idea or conception stage, what happens? That if I go to the market, because of the various uncertainties that are there at this stage, what happens? The risk to business is very high. Therefore, you don't go to the market at that stage. But as you go up this particular chain, your business risk goes from high to low. So you start going lower business risk. That is the reason you get a higher return on the value of IP. So the realizable value goes up. Why? Because the risk to the business is coming down. Now, so you can see here in this yellow box, which says ideas to realization and marketing tangibles. So it goes up in this particular way. Value maximization to business and markets and society goes up as you go along this particular chain. But all this is very important, that where does the government come in? The government comes in because of the impact of national policies. There were the national research policies, the national IP policies, the national regulatory policies. All these become an integral part of the entire process. So we need to understand all these processes, which are very important. And therefore, on the left side, I've called it thoughts to things. So thoughts are going to things, thoughts to things. So it is going from intangibles to tangible assets. So it becomes, that means something, it is intangible going into becoming tangible assets. And intellectual property rights is an intangible right, but for tangible benefits. Now, in all this, I've just put an equation. It says innovation value chain, I call it efficiency E. It's like Einstein's equation, the E is, equal to mc square. I'm not saying it is mc square. I'm saying it is mc cube. What is the mc cube? M is mind, the value of mind. Then the value of concepts. The value you get in commerce as you go to the market, and very important, is competition. Why? Because if there is no competition in market, there's only monopolistic things, and the whole thing will crash. Therefore, this whole cycle has to enhance competition. And only when it enhances competition, that society gets the maximum value of such creations. So this is a very, very important and significant aspect. Let's go to the next slide. So next slide, please. Let's go to the next slide. Now, this is something that we have done so far. Now, these are photographs I took when I went to Oman a couple of years ago, sitting on the sand dunes there. Now, I'm saying that when you look at this, now, I'm not going to touch COVID, because a lot has been said. But what is going to happen post-COVID? Very important. Everybody has said it, and that's what I call as it is an immutable scenario. Imminent global economic recession is coming in. Everybody has said it. I don't want to elaborate, but everybody knows it. There'll be very cautioned investments, that also everybody knows. There will be, obviously, people will have less money, so there'll be reduction in personal spending. There'll be change in consumption culture. There'll be increased demand for, very important, there'll be increased demand for affordable products and services, because people won't have so much money. And because if people don't have so much money, affordability is going to become a major issue. So affordable products and services. And then there'll be divergent prioritized needs. And then there'll be thrust for innovation, because innovation has to be there. Because without innovation, you are not going to solve the problem. So innovation is a continuous process. It has to. And very important, it'll drive multilateralism. It'll drive synergies, and it'll drive competition. So it's extremely important that these are issues that we'll be facing, you know, as the time goes on. Let's go to the next slide. And you will see that this is a sunset which I'm showing. Therefore, after legacy set, you know, after the COVID sets, what is going to happen? Go to the next slide. And the next slide is a very important slide. Next one, please. Yeah. So, you know, whatever has been the traditional approaches, no, previous slide, please, do not change. Please go to the previous slide. Can we get back to the previous slide? Yeah. So, legacy approaches will have to be abandoned. You know, whatever we have done in the past, we cannot be like ostriches putting our heads in the soil, or like the three monkeys, where you say, I will not hear, I will not speak, I will not listen. No, you have to need to create contextual frameworks for speedy and accountable delivery. Very important. So this is something that we need to do into it. And that is what we need to do. So go to the next slide. Again, it's a picture when I went to the Jabal Sams, the very rugged scenario, and therefore I'm saying post COVID is going to be a rugged terrain to test human R&D abilities, and to do that we'll need to reconfigure strategies and resources. So this is something that we need to do. We go to the next slide. So how do we cross these rugged terrains that will happen in the post COVID scenario in R&D? And therefore it's a time for enormous amount of contemplation. And therefore this particular photograph, this is myself sitting in that one of the major sand dunes and watching the desert which is sprawling in front. And I see post COVID as a major desert in front, and how do we create opportunities in this particular desert? So the priority areas, according to me, will be affordable access to healthcare, food and shelter, supply chain logistics, predictive modeling, smart disaster management, and remodeling of education systems. This is one part. And the other part, which is extremely important, is that there will be tremendous amount of importance on digital connectivity, new learning and training, including entertainment systems, knowledge sharing modes, data acquisition, analysis and trading. And then, of course, how will we strategically exploit artificial intelligence? So it's not per se artificial intelligence, but strategically exploiting artificial intelligence. And simultaneously, we'll have to create business and funding models for very agile operations. So this is something, is a very holistic challenge. But this holistic challenge is going to really take on, and therefore if we want to do R&D into this particular field, the R&D part will have to address issues of this type. And this is something where we will need the synergy between all the stakeholders that we talked about. So taking this further, we go to the next slide. So the next slide, please. So then we ask ourselves in the next slide, imperatives in post-COVID scenario. So not to repeat, but change economic structures with parallel resource crunch. There'll be resource crunch. So if there is resource crunch, we have to know how to use our resources in the most effective manner. So that's a resource crunch. Affordability in the marketplace is going to be a dominant factor, very important. And then enhanced need for cost-effective sharing of resources, including interdependencies through balanced benefit sharing of intellectual property rights and knowledge in the open domain. And this will be inter and international sharing of knowledge. Now, this is easier said than done. So the question is, how do we create this cost-effective sharing of resources? How do we create these interdependencies through very important term, balanced benefit sharing of intellectual property rights? Because please understand, intellectual property rights is a property and the rights that one gets out of that. And then knowledge, both in the open domain and putting it all together, all this will have to be looked at not only from a national point of view, but also from an international point of view. So we need to look at all this from the total and holistic fashion. As we go to the next slide, we'll continue our discussion on imperatives in the post-COVID-19 scenario, where we are talking about operationalization of collective innovations, propelling the need for what I call as collaborative competitors. So now, competitors, instead of fighting with each other, they'll have to learn how to collaborate. But see what I have marked in blue here. Without collusion, that means they cannot come together, to create monopoly. They have to come together and yet remain as competitors and yet collaborate. So I call it as a shift from confrontational to synergistic, symbiotic, cooperative vision for accelerated deliveries for minds to markets, evolve new IP sharing models, including establishing platforms for creative micro licensing. So very important. So we'll have to go to completely new models in intellectual property rights. And yes, people will get intellectual property rights. People will get patents. People will get trademarks. People will get all these things. But very important is that how with each one of us having our own intellectual property rights, having our own ideas, having our own things, how do we come together into a sharing platform? How do we share all these things and work together and yet remain as competitors in the market so that society gets everything at most affordable prices? So this is a very important part, and please understand that if businesses don't earn, they cannot sustain. Therefore, you have to ensure there should be business sustainability, or that there will be no research, there will be no production, there will be nothing. So in doing so, this is a very, very complex part, which will be an imperative in the post-COVID scenario. Now, let's look at the next issue, which is regulatory agencies to play the roles as what I call as national contextual facilitators, rather than installing bureaucratic cobwebs and death trapping innovations and businesses into procedural black holes. I've put in the term black hole. Black hole, as you know, where energy goes in and does not come out. And procedural black holes, and you go into this particular procedural situs, and it is a complete death trap of innovations and businesses. So regulatory agencies will have to change. So it's not only intellectual property rights, with all these, but regulatory bodies will also have to change their modes out there. Now, let's go to the next slide. The next slide, please. As we go into the next slide, again, I bring in the concept of accessibility to products and services, but with affordability. Very important. So this is going to be a major driving force in research and development, where you can give businesses will have to give accessibility with affordability. There's no question about it in the post-COVID scenario. Now, IPR holders' rights are very important, and they have to be balanced with IPR holders' responsibilities and societal obligations. So there has to be a balance. But if the society or the government, after what is society, the government has given me certain rights, then question is, if the society has given me rights, then I have certain responsibilities and obligations towards society. So how do I meet those obligations towards society? I can meet that only by making accessibility of my products and services with affordability. Very, very important part. Let's go to the next slide. Therefore, what are the issues to be addressed? Many issues. I'll just take a few. Very, as all of us know, I call it several innovations get orphaned. For it's an orphan without parents. Why? Because the parents have died. The businesses have gone away. No money due to improper management and pre and post innovation processes. So we must know how to manage so that our innovations do not get orphaned. Consequences of not working of innovations by IP holders in reasonable time. Therefore, you cannot only exercise your monopoly, but you have to be also making it available to public. Therefore, you cannot just take a patent, you cannot just take something and not use it and make it available to public. You must make it available to public. And that is where you would be exercising your rights on one side while being fair and equitable. Very important is that after I get my rights, have I informed people what am I doing with the rights? That's called working of IPR by holders. Now, this working of working is a very important part, so that once you do this, then the government must bring in appropriate process, being mindful of present and future business dynamics. It cannot be just a law. It cannot be just a procedure, but it must be realistic in terms of future business dynamics. Very, very important. And incentives for equitable knowledge sharing to knowledge creators and knowledge holders. And very important is create frameworks for utilization of exclusion. So every law, including intellectual property rights law, have what are known as some exclusions and limitations. That is what people can do, allowed by law, you know, to do things without the permission of the right holder. So there are certain things. So one thinks very holistically in the post-COVID scenario, all these parameters are going to play a very, very important role in R&D and also in all these particular bits. Let's go to the next slide. So question that comes in doing all this, information systems play a very important role. So how does one make knowledge available at stakeholders' homes? And this is where the National Digital Library of India comes in, NDLI, which produces a solution. Now let's look at the next slide. And this is, if all of you are aware, I put on the a screenshot from NDLI. As you will see, it's an initiative of the Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India, implemented by Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. A super inclusive knowledge resource. And if you go to this particular site, you will see how rich this particular site is, that it has been able to become a repository, integrating contents from different Indian institutional repositories and also from different parts of the world. So this is one of the finest examples of how technology has been put together with information science, making it available to public, making it available to researchers, making it available to one and all. Go to the next slide. So in doing so, I've been very privileged to be a part of this particular team working in IIT Kharagpur. So then what is the demand on information specialists? Very important. Information specialists now are going to play a very important role. And that important role is that exploit state-of-art knowledge, data storage, sharing modes, including research information systems and digital libraries with effective use of AI systems and social platforms to support researchers with smart, important part is not just documentation, but smart documentation and dissemination. Enable peer review systems for research output evaluation. Periodic issuance of landscaping reports, including IPR status in research areas to minimize duplication of prior art. And then publication industry, of course, we know will undergo a major transformation and adjust to the digital realities with regard to copyright and other related issues. So very, very important out there. And this is where I think, you know, companies like Informatics and all the others, Googles of the world, Informatics, others, are going to be extremely important in all these particular things. Can we go to the next slide, please? I'm not going to spend too much time, but I just picked up this slide from a webinar which I attended on 14th of May. And this person, Francisco Marmeloja, he presented this particular slide. See what it's saying. The shifting distribution of global stock of people with tertiary education. So look at 2013, the distribution around the world, and look at 2030, the prediction. Look at the value, the position that India and China is going to take in 2030 vis-a-vis the rest of the world. Extremely important. And therefore, we need to now address, it says global distribution of tertiary educated all between 25 and 34 years old. So if you look at this, India today is the youngest country in the world. And you can see that we will have to take care of the interest of the young people who will now be doing research. Less people will go abroad. More people will be in India. Though the pressure on Indian institutions are going to be extremely high. And therefore, the question is, how do we take these particular bits to the next step? Next slide, please. So the question that comes in, how do we prepare IPR literate and still employable human resource in our educational institutions? And if several years ago, I developed a model, I called it IPR internalization, IPR internalize. And this is something that I practiced in various institutions. I will very briefly show one slide on that. So can we go to the next slide? So the question is that everyone says introduce IPR in the coursework, but simply introducing that at a theoretical level does not really train people. So the question that comes in is, how do you frame? So this particular slide in this model in, you know, I call it model internalized. Okay. And I've trademarked it as well. This particular bit tells us how we can train people so that at the end of their regular BSc, BA, MA, whatever they may do, and PhD, how do we create employable personnel equipped with the right attitude and skill, prepared for higher education, prepared for entrepreneurship, and then therefore, how do we create a rich human resource in the country using institutional output while going through this particular process? So this is a value addition to education. Can we go to the next slide? Next slide, please. Yeah, and I come to this towards the end, latter part of this, and that is regulatory agencies play a very important role in this value addition process. Why? They should act as contextual facilitators rather than installing bureaucratic cobwebs. I'm being very strong, I'm being extremely provocative, but I'm being very real. Death trapping innovations and businesses into procedural black holes. And this, I want to illustrate that how certain things are operating, even in our country, specifically vis-a-vis the healthcare industry. And I want to illustrate this using that. So can we go to the next slide? Now, if you look at the post-COVID scenario, what is going to be important in the healthcare industry? Development, production, and sale of active pharmaceutical ingredients, what we call as API, formulations and drug delivery systems, biotech technology products, biosimilars, vaccines. We are all hearing so much about all these nowadays. Natural products and raw materials from India, Indian biodiversity for use in products, medical devices, hospital supplies and diagnostics. You can see we do, all our institutions do so much research on all this. Question is, what is coming to the market and why are things not coming into the market, which are developed in India very much? So let's look at some constraints and that we'll have to overcome in the COVID scenario. So the next slide, please. I don't want to go into too much of details of this, but very important, there is an organization called DCGI. That is, the in Delhi, and they are the ones who clear or give authorization for whether you can market your products to the as pharmaceutical products into the market. Now, interesting part, in our DGI, we do not have the provision for emergency use authorization. So, in an emergency situation, there should be special provisions to bypass certain parts, but we don't have it. Therefore, what happens is all cases are channelized to the same bureaucratic, what I call as roller coaster, irrespective of their urgency, importance. Such provisions are included in US, Europe, and other countries. Somehow, strangely, we don't have it in India. Number two, requirements for approval are identical irrespective of disease profile and unmet medical needs. And this is not anywhere else in the world, it's somehow here. Interestingly, our regulatory agencies are not risk averse. So these look for approvals elsewhere. So if you show them that, I've got an approval in the US, then they say, okay, I'm prepared to look at yours. If I don't have approval somewhere else, then everything goes very slow. So what does it mean? So are we saying that what we do here, we don't have confidence? I'm questioning this particular bit. So I'm being very provocative on this particular part. Let's go to the next slide. Next slide, please. And in this, the important part is that, there are questions which are raised by regulatory agencies. They provide no guidance. So multiple rounds of queries go on and inordinate delays. And therefore, even if we innovate good products, it takes years to go to the market. And India has additional bureaucratic layers, especially when you come to genetic modifications and all those things, which are outside and it goes under a different framework. So now you're multi-layered bureaucratic processes. And very, very strange that when we go through all these particular processes, important part that those who are researchers listening to this, interesting part is that if you're doing work in pharmaceuticals area, if you're doing in pharmaceutical area, then what happens? That regulatory, if it says that, look, you must go to the state FDA and take a prior permission before initiating research work. Now, will you be doing that or what will you do? I mean, there is complete mess in this country. Similarly, for clearance of vaccines, there is again another separate issue. So the question that comes in, all these need to be addressed. Let's go to the next slide. So I'm saying that after all the corporate processes and delays, even if clearance is obtained, none of the agencies are accountable for post-clearance issues. So therefore, what is happening? Most companies, in India who do research, in fact, most of the companies who are doing the clinical trials, they prefer to do the clinical trials abroad and not in India, because they get tied up in India with a complete corporate bureaucratic process, and therefore it becomes a major issue. So people said, well, with it, let me go out and do these trials. Very, very important. And therefore, most researchers in all these institutions, you know, now research, the universities, for example, or any of the IITs or others, are they aware that they have to go to a regulatory body to take a priority approval and all that? Now, if you don't, the data you generate cannot be submitted to regulatory bodies. So the industry who will take the technology from you or the proof of concept from you will have to repeat a whole bunch of things, and that way everything will get delayed. So very important in all these. Let's go to the next slide. Yeah. So then the other issue is Indian biodiversity, you know, Indian biodiversity, when we use materials, we have to take certain clearances from the National Biodiversity Board, which is in an absolute total confusion and mess. And as a result of that, what happens, Indian innovators and entrepreneurs are being deprived of the fruits of their R&D and are losing out on inventions gained elsewhere. So that gets marketed easier than the products that we do using materials from Indian biodiversity. So we need to address all these issues. Post-COVID is going to produce this challenge to the government to come with the right policies. Therefore, go to the next slide. And therefore, the question which I'm raising, that obviously all these systems need complete overhauling to be effective in the post-COVID scenario. That can India afford the continuance of legacy regulatory structures, processes, and systems if we want to lead healthcare sector in the world despite high quality indigenous human resource? So I'm suggesting this needs enormous amount of review. It needs an immediate critical national policy review and possibly the creation of a new ministry under which one ministry to bring in all these things under one head, so that the bureaucratic processes become less problematic. Next slide, please. And therefore, before I come to the last slide, I'm bringing in issues of artificial intelligence and how do we exploit blockchain technologies, not only for our regulatory processes, but also for our research and IP systems out there. Next slide. And therefore, in conclusion, next slide, please. So in conclusion, I'm saying we need tailored transformative innovation pathways, designing of new models for research and development intertwined with IPR to deliver value-enhanced R&D output in most cost-effective and sustainable manner. Research community have to identify and prioritize areas for research, exploit operative models of cooperative working with equitable benefit sharing of IPR, set up knowledge supply chains and supply channels for production and delivery. So obviously you need to link up with industry much early. Knowledge and data sharing modes, including research information systems and digital libraries with effective use of artificial intelligence systems and social platforms, and national policies to address streamlining of regulatory agencies to function with accountability as facilitators of innovation for rapid diffusion in the market. Extremely important. And therefore, the last slide, I could not resist but to show you a very interesting thing that was written again. So go to the next slide, please. And therefore, in this part, I again go back to Rabindranath Tagore and see what he wrote in 1901. How many years ago? 120 years ago, practically, he wrote. where the mind is without fear and the head is held high, where knowledge is free, where the world has not been broken into fragments by narrow domestic walls. So that is where internationalization becomes, multilateralism becomes very important. Where words come from the depth of truth, where tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection. That's where R&D comes in. A clear stream of reason has not lost its way into dreary desert stand of dead habit. You know, that's where our regulatory systems and others come in. The mind is led forward by thee into ever-widening thought and action, into that heaven of freedom my father led my country away. Thank you very much. I hand it over to Dr. Bhairappa.
Thank you, Professor Ganguly, for an excellent talk. We have about 730 people attended that, and we got about 24 questions in Q&A session. And we also got questions. Now floor is open for question and answer. Now we may not have enough time to cover all questions, but let me have a privilege to choose some questions and pose them to the speaker, Professor Ganguly. So the first question you have is from B. Subbalakshmi. That is the last question. Actually, I'm asking it as a first question. Can a newly invented crypto system be patented? In general, can any computer program be patented?
In principle, computer programs can be patented. However, there's a rider that I don't want to go into details of the law, but the law says that that particular computer program should not be a computer program per se. And therefore, one has to go into the legal interpretation. What is the meaning of the term computer program per se? So if I can prove that my computer program is not a computer program per se, then in principle it can be patented. However, then it will then have to go into the next step, and that is there are certain conditions for patentability. And when it goes into the examination, it must satisfy additional conditions of what is known as novelty. Simply newness is not good enough. So it must satisfy what is known as novelty. It must satisfy what is known as inventive step. That means it must not be obvious to a person skilled in the art. And it must have some applications, that it must be useful. It must be capable of industrial application. So if it satisfies all that, yes, a computer program in principle can be patent.
Okay. The second question we have is, how do we address the issue of democratizing data by doing away with paywalls?
Okay.
Third question.
So, yeah. Now, see, when you take democratization of data, that does not mean data is open and free to all. There are issues. The first data, whose is the data? And therefore, it's extremely important. The ownership of data becomes very, very important. So therefore, democratization of data does not mean free use of data. So then obviously you got to pay for it if it is so. But certain type of data which are required for certain types, that much is made available to people so that the competition opens up and everybody uses that data to develop their applications, etc. So one will have to be very qualified. There cannot be a general answer to a question like this.
The next question is from Sargo Sudarshan Rao. His question is related to the title of the talk. He says the innovation/findings of the identified problem being the first to get the IPR phase and marketable value, etc. How can we say that the research and IPR intertwined?
Oh, very good question. Very good question. See, if you take research and IPR, so what is it? When we do research, the first thing we are doing is we have an unmet need. There's a problem and I'm solving the unmet need. Now, while solving the unmet need, I invent something, right? So when I solve that, I go to that unmet need. Now it is completely my choice whether I want to own it. Do I want to own my own creation, or I don't want to own the creation? Do I want to give it to people? Now, if I want to own it, then I make it my property. How do I make it my property? I go through the legal process and take patent, trademark, copyright, etc., etc., and make that as my property. Now, when I make it my property, this becomes a part of my thing. Now, when I'm doing all this, I have to also ensure that I'm not infringing somebody else's IPR. So then I must take that into consideration. So therefore, you can see how IPR is intertwined in with my research. Otherwise, I may come with something which is a complete copy of somebody's. Now, yeah, I may go and tell, but I was not aware. But please understand, in this game, ignorance is not bliss. It's okay in English literature, but not in business. So very important, therefore it is intertwined. So question is, how do you manage this intertwining of the process? Therefore it is intertwined.
Okay, thank you. So next question is from Hanumantu Purushottam. This question is about compulsory licensing aspect. He wants to know your thoughts. So the question is, in case vaccine for COVID comes in next 3-4 months in the international market, will India be able to issue compulsory license for it to India so that the local manufacturer can really produce that and supply in India?
See, compulsory license is never the first option. Compulsory license is always a last option. So the first option is that whoever owns it, whether they are able to, that's why I brought in that we have to think in the post-COVID era or during this particular era, ways of sharing with fair benefit sharing arrangements. So we need to look at all these things in terms of being fair. And because if you're not fair benefit sharing, what will happen that it will not, businesses will not be sustainable. Investments will not take place. So the question is that whole issue of fair benefit sharing is a very important part. And the compulsory license only will be a last option, not as the first option. We don't jump to compulsory license as the first option. We first go to voluntary. We first go to seeing how we can manage. And that's why the new models, new business models with intellectual property rights is going to be very important. How we will have to do it is something that needs to be worked out in detail.
Next one is very simple, fundamental question on copyright. The question is, what is the process to protect copyright of digital content?
Now, very important is, see, in copyright, that unlike in the case of trademark or patent, the moment you do the work, you have become the copyright owner, provided you have documented the things properly. So you become the copyright owner of that. So if I create, you know, like in classical terms, we used to say that the moment the pen leaves the paper, whatever you have created becomes your copyright. A photographer takes a photograph, it becomes his copy. It does not have to register. So in other cases, you have to register. In these cases, you don't necessarily have to register. But registration is important for other purposes out there. But it's extremely important to establish that I did it, when did I do it, all the documentation, etc. are very important. And that is how you go about it.
So next question is about IPR career. You had a beautiful slide about IPR, you know, possibility of having it, making it to curriculum. The question is, how to make a career in IPR field? Are there any like schools in IPR? What is the way to make a career in IPR?
A very good question. It's an extremely good question. First of all, to make a, you know, when you take IPR, the intellectual property rights, there are what are known as patents, there are trademarks, there's copyright. Then, you know, you have geographical indications, you have design registrations, all those things. Are there trademarks? So you have to learn all these things. And for these, certain institutions are offering diplomas, certificate courses are there. Then very important, the World Intellectual Property Organization. I work as a consultant to the World Intellectual Property Organization, which is the UN organization. And the World Intellectual Property Organization also runs a lot of free courses out there, online courses. You can take those, and if you have gone through all that, then you can appear for the exams that are conducted by the Indian Patent Office, and you can qualify as a patent agent. You can start practicing, but of course you need training, you need how to go about all those. And then of course, if you want to go to the next higher level, then you can join a law school. Like I teach in the Rajiv Gandhi School for Intellectual Property Law in IIT Kharagpur. Like this, there are so many national law schools in Nalsar, Hyderabad. There are all these other things. So you can really join all those. So there are a lot of opportunities. And then it needs a lot of rigorous training to really get into all this. Like I started my career way back. Now it must be the 25th year that I've been in the field of IPR. So, and I must tell you, in 25 years of my career, not one moment I've regretted getting into this particular field. It's been so exciting and contemporary. So yes, you can take this as a career.
Okay. So probably we can take last two questions. Last but one is from Ishappa Bandi. His question is about novelty aspect or the prior art related question. So can IPR or a patent registration platform showcase ongoing research or innovation so that it can be used to avoid duplication?
Yes, because all this information is available in public domain. And therefore it's extremely important. And that's why what we do, we continuously train people, researchers, of how to look for this information. So that when you do your, you know, in my slide, one of my slides at the concept, I had a box where it said, you do these particular searches, all this is available in public domain. So we need to go into the public, you can actually access all this free. So you can go there, you into all the different databases, search it, put the whole thing together, and then you can put down something like a landscaping and then decide, you know, what should be your strategy of work so that you don't repeat what is already known.
Okay. The last question probably we can take is, it appears that government, I mean, this is an opinion, they need your thoughts on this. It appears that government-funded research in India is hardly based upon in-depth prior art search. Consequently, number of patents getting granted is less than 20%.
Well, I mean, this is something that as researchers, right? I mean, see, what can government do? Government can't do much. The researchers and the research organizations will have to solve this. They will have to do the searches. They have the libraries. They have the information systems. They have to do all that. Now, if they don't do it, then how, you can't blame the funder. The funding agency is giving you the money. The research process is yours. This is the first part of the research process. And if you don't do that research process, you're failing in your whole process of doing research. You're trying to do a shortcut and therefore paying the price at the end. So yes, we need to train people to do this. In fact, just to tell you, only about a week ago, in fact, this will be made available to the public. Only a week ago, we have written from IIT Jodhpur. We have just written a very simple guide on for researchers on how to do prior art search before they take up research. And you know, IIT Jodhpur library has published it, and I'm sure they're going to make it public in very soon. And we have just published it under a complete Creative Commons license. So that anybody can download, anybody can study it, anybody can use it. So we want to propagate and ensure that we do high quality research.
So thank you very much, sir, for a wonderful talk and also very meaningful interactions with the people who asked questions. And it was so, you know, insightful and meaningful. We learned a lot and we have so many takeaways from your talk. And so before I conclude, you know, I would like to share a couple of points. So as I said, you know, first time I heard on IPR and copyright from Professor Ganguly was in 2007-2008 in GE. And so I moved from GE to, you know, IISc. Out of curiosity, I was looking at research. And if you look at research, what are the three outcomes? One is publications, or how do you measure research? Publications, patents, and products. So interestingly, there are about 70,000 products, new products being launched every year, and 95% of them are a failure. So there is an article, you know, I can share that article. That's about products. Patents and publications, obviously, if you look at the entire publications portfolio is dominated by academics. globally, and there is a very little presence by universities and academics in patent portfolio. And I did a search and I figured out, you know, what is that percentage? 97% of the total patent portfolio is dominated by corporates across the world. I'm aware about, you know, MITs, Cornells and all of that. Only 3% of the patent portfolio in the world is with academics and government. Interesting. And the and also to justify further, recently, you know, Government of India has come out with AIA ranking on patents, innovations, and all of that. If you look at top five AIA ranked institutions in India, IIC and IITs, and 1 year patent portfolio of all these top five will be less than 700. And to add to that, India's number one IT company, if you look at TCS, their annual patent filings are 5,200 plus. So that talks about very distinguished and very clear cut domination of, you know, patents and publications. And so I thought of really sharing that with you. And also most of the times when we work in academics, people get confused with a lot of things. And thanks to Professor Ganguly for giving clarification and all of that. One of the things many people get confused here is copyright and the fair use. So it's very important that we all understand. And you, when you work in organizations, somebody wants to clear a copyright. How do you really clear copyright? And that's very important. Practical things of it. Everybody talks about copyright and all of that. There are international organizations, for example, CCC, Copyright Clearance Agency in US. And they have a catalog, like publisher's catalog. You go search for it. Whatever document you want, it will throw up the price, you pay the money, and you can be compliant. And if you want to really make your entire organization copyright compliant, CCC also has an organization-wide tool called RightsLink. What it does, if you implement that in the organization network, it will keep track of all the publication access points. And at the end, it will tell you, you know, which are the documents you accessed for did not have subscription to our copyright. So there are some ways and solutions to be 100% copyright compliant in case if you have willingness to really do that. So with that, I would like to thank Satya again, Informatics, for giving me this opportunity to chair this session. I really enjoyed, I learned a lot from Professor Ganguly's talk, and thank you for all 635 participants who spared their time in the busy schedule and joined the webinar. And thank you all for a wonderful learning experience. Over.
Thank you, Dr. Anand. As it is said, all good things must come to an end, and we have now reached the end of this webinar on intellectual property right and value enhancement. It was an interesting and knowledgeable presentation by Professor Ganguly, starting from innovation in the words of Rabindranath Tagore and concluding with the words of Rabindranath Tagore, taking us through the process of IPR internalize, the new term that we learned today, and then redefining the potential of IPR in the entire process of research and value enhancement. Thank you, Professor Ganguly, for having spared your valuable time for an audience who really loved your presentation, which is evident from the kind of questions that we have got today and the kind of questions that were sent to us prior to the starting of the webinar. Thank you very much for your valuable time and sparing your knowledge with us. I would also like to thank Dr. Anand, who chaired the webinar, interacting virtually with the participants who sent their questions and shortlisting questions and then sharing it with Professor Ganguly and with the audience. I would like to take this opportunity to thank 739 participants, 739 to 623 as of now, who spared their valuable time and have been on this platform for almost 1.5 hours now. I'm sure this webinar would have given them some value enhancement in terms of IPR and their research processes. And we hope that they would be joining us in these kind of webinars in future too, and gain more knowledge and information from the webinars that Informatics would be conducting in due course of time. Here, I would also like to make two announcements. We have been receiving a lot of requests for certificates. As you are aware, the gathering here of 730 people was a diverse gathering, and we would issue certificates to those who require these certificates. We request you to kindly send your email for your e-certificate request, and we would be honoring those requests. The second request that we also found frequently on this webinar was sharing of the PPT slides. We would be sharing the entire recording of this webinar to all the participants in the, I think in the next couple of hours, an email would go from our end to all the participants giving the link to this webinar, and they can download the recording and see it whenever they want. So thank you very much for joining us, and wish you all good luck. Stay safe and stay healthy. Thank you.